You know, there's going to be moments in your life where the pressure's on. You know, the bottom of the ninth, two outs, you got to make that clutch home run. Got to score that basket for the free throw, the three-pointer for that game-winning shot. But none of them are going to pale in comparison to those early round picks to make those correct players that are going to take you to the fantasy championship. Yo, what is going on, 32-Bit Nation? It is your boy, Natter. And if you didn't know already, today's episode, we're going to be talking about those early round picks. But more specifically, we're going to be doing a miniature mock draft on those early round picks. And because of that, we're going to be breaking down each pick, who we want in that certain scenario. Oh, that player got taken. Oh, okay, then we're going to fall back to this guy. Because as you know, everybody's got a plan until they get punched in the mouth. But of course, in this episode, I have a couple of legends altogether. Of course, first off, we got Mr. Eric Moody of ESPN and Sports Betting Analysis. Mr. Moody, how you doing over there?
Nah, things are going great. It's August. You know, training camps are going on. We've got NFL preseason games where the full gamut is about to take place here this weekend. So if I were doing any better, I'd be a twin. Things are great. Oh, yeah.
You know, my favorite part about you, Mr. Eric, is that your name's really easy to pronounce. And I really appreciate that. We've had a handful of guests where I have to pre-rehearse saying their names because it's so difficult and I'll still get it wrong and I just look really stupid. But of course, alongside us, we also have Mr. Tip. What's going on, man?
What's up, brother? What's going on, Eric Moody, man? This is royalty right here. So this is awesome, man. So, you know, I'm excited about this. I'm excited to draft with you guys because that is the single most like thing that I love to do most when I'm in fantasy.
All right, you still with us?
For kind what your season is going to look at.
There he is.
Uh-oh. Okay, because that sets that the tone for... No, you I was going to say, moment. I love draft season. I love this part of the year because it sets the tone for your team. Exactly. So, you know, it's... This right here is just as important as those weeks when we're in the playoffs and we're trying to, you know, look at trends, figure out who we're going to play, things of those sorts, easy schedules. Are they playing outdoors, indoors? What are they looking? That is the same thing we're looking at right now, guys. We're looking at a lot of different things in a big picture. So it's fun. I love it.
Oh, yeah. Usually we try to tell people the draft will get you to the playoffs. The waiver wire will get you to the championship. And in this episode, we're going to be setting up that foundation to put you into the playoffs because, so, you know, everybody has different mindsets or philosophies on how to draft. Mine personally is I want reliable players in the early round picks and ones that aren't going to necessarily just blow the top off the team to add points, but foundational pieces that are consistent, that are going to put me in positions to succeed. Now, of course, in the beginning, I'm going to mess with you guys a little bit. I like to ask some questions and Mr. Eric, let's see. What's a good one for you? Oh, you know what? I've always wanted to know this. Okay. Sure. So obviously, you know, you're in do you work in the ESPN studio or are you working from home?
Yeah, I work from home. So I'm remote. I'm not in Bristol. I'm in Dallas, Texas. So
shoot. Well, that kind of almost ruins my question because I was going to ask you because I know the ESPN, there's a lot of green screens and a lot of lights. I've always wanted to know how hot it gets in there.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that it gets very hot. I'm like, sometimes you'll have like lights on you, but it's not overbearing. I would probably say the thing whenever I did have my first in studio, the big studio appearance. First of all, it's a lot bigger than what you expect, like the room itself. But then like the table that you're sitting at, it's a lot smaller than I expected. But I would say the one thing that I had to get used to was when you're kind of in that environment is, you know, where you're having a lot of cameras around, having to look directly at that camera kind of get your point across. But I'll leave you with this. Another thing too, is that I love doing shows like this because it's more laid back. It's, you can let things breathe, but when you're on air, like in a studio show like that, you really only have like 30 to 50 seconds tops to get your point across. And if you don't, you're going to have a producer in your ear saying rap, 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 like finish it up.
So when they have those earpieces, like kind of like wrapped up behind their neck, like there's actual communication going on.
Oh yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You'll have, hold on a second. We kind of have something, we have a little fun tonight. So we kind of have something like this, right? Give me a sec here. You'll have like, you know, your earpiece here. You'll have this in, right?
Okay.
And you'll have people kind of communicating with you. So you'll have that stuck like in your ear. And there is talking and things that are going on whenever you're going through stuff. Things happen. Things change. I remember something that was really funny like a couple of years ago was where we did we're talking about the mock draft, right? So we did the mock draft and we were doing like a show. The night before, I'm just trying to think. And it was some news breaking. And so, like, in between, like, commercial breaks, I remember, like, chatting with, like, Adam Schefter because he was there. And we're just chatting, you know, kind of catching up. Then all of a sudden, he's like, hey, just give me 1 minute. So he kind of pulls out his phone. He steps, like, aside, and he's, like, you know, talking to someone. You know, he's talking and then sending some texts. And so, like, news was breaking, like, right there. Uh-huh. So he was getting the intel. So he comes over and it's like, I forgot the event, but it's just like, you know, this happened. We're all trying to adjust to talk about at least what happened. Wow. So it's just funny because, you know, you see Schefter's tweets. You're like, does this guy ever sleep? You know, it's like 3 a.m. You know, this guy's like posting, you know, NFL news. And so it's funny kind of seeing how he operates where you at least have a chance to spend a couple of hours with him. So I know that was kind of one funny story, like when my first time doing these in studio shows.
That's crazy. Also, okay. Yeah. Also, when the thing is wrapped up in your ear and they are talking while you're making a point, have you ever lost your train of thought mid-sentence?
I have not. They tried not to communicate whenever someone is going through like a take. Yeah. Stating like their opinion. So they try not to do that. The only time when they come into your ear is when you're talking too long.
Too long. Okay. That's
so you got to have like an internal clock. It kind of reminds me when I played like offensive line, like football, just knowing, okay, I've got about 30 to 40 seconds to make a point. Let me get in and get out like quick. It's always trying to make it a point to not have to have anyone in my ear saying rap because I've already wrapped it up before they even need to say it.
That's fair enough. Fair enough.
It's funny. It's funny when you say wrap it up, it just reminds me of this Chappelle episode where he's like, wrap it up, Pete. You got to wrap it up. And he has a wrap it up box. Oh, yes. Man, that's crazy.
When you say wrap it up, like, what are we wrapping up? Hold on.
No, he's like, stop talking.
No, okay. Yeah. I thought it was we're talking about wrapping up. So, okay, never mind. My bad.
No. My bad.
All right. Well, that'll transition. So, of course, you know, right now through training camp, there's a lot of injuries. Yeah. And there's going to be more. And I always tell people, if you do your fantasy redraft specifically before preseason starts, you are a sociopath. And you enjoy the pain of the injuries and what's to come. Or you're that guy that drafts people and you're looking at those injuries and you're like, oh my God, he drafted that guy. Your season's over. You saw and all that. I mean, I'm not going to blame somebody for doing that. I just think you're a sociopath for it. But of course, you know, I'm going to list a couple of players where the injuries happen, obviously. And we're going to talk about if this impacts their ADP, where you're drafting them, if you even want to draft them, or you know what, you have the full confidence in it. Now, Tip, I was going to ask you as a for fun question, but then I was going to be like, oh, wait, you think Bijan Robinson is RB1, and that's already fun in itself. But now Christian McCaffrey strained his calf and is considered week to week, not day to day, week to week. And he's not playing in preseason. And I believe this was the same calf that he hurt last year as well. So, of course, we're going to start with Moody. Are you scared of Christian McCaffrey's calf?
Yeah, I would say scared is such a strong word. I am definitely concerned, but I find it difficult to not draft him first overall if you have the 101.
Exactly.
You just look at his body of work, statistical body of work. Like he had 391 fantasy points last season, the most of any player. And it's ironic because he had nearly 101 more fantasy points than the RB2, you know, Breece Hall. And so, and you look at the volume that he gets too. It's hard looking at running backs because they don't all get consistent volume. We know McCaffrey's going to get that workload. So, you know, Kyle Shanahan and this 49ers staff, I feel confident that they'll give him the rest that he needs. But I just don't think you're going to get a discount on Christian McCaffrey in fantasy drafts. If that's what managers are hoping for, I just don't see that happening.
I wish. Tip, how do you feel now?
I mean, we already know his injury history. We already know that he has had a lot of touches, you know, especially if you count the playoff touches he's had the last few years too, playing in San Francisco. So that right there in and of itself, and he's already in training camp and has a calf injury, and we all know how tricky soft tissue injuries are, specifically a calf, and you're a running back and you got to run off of it. You got to use your calf to burst. So, you know, this is, you know, I know, you know, Eric didn't want to use the word scary, but this is scary, especially if I already have drafted and I picked Christian McCaffrey my number one pick. This is panic mode. You are actually sitting at your computer watching reports on Christian McCaffrey as we speak, and you're going to be watching it for the next couple of weeks because you want to make sure that calf is getting better, it's healing properly. But if you are a Christian McCaffrey owner, the question you need to ask yourself now is, am I going to go with Elijah Mitchell? Am I going to go, they just added Matt Breida. Who am I going to pick as that handcuff? Hopefully you had somebody to handcuff, but if you didn't, that's tough. It's tough.
Well, as of right now, the 49ers have 8 running backs signed on their roster. Do I realistically think they're going to start the season with 8 running backs? I mean, Shanahan is known to enjoy running back, maybe. But if you do take Christian McCaffrey, you must absolutely take the handcuff, in my personal opinion. But unfortunately, it's who is the handcuff? Because Elijah Mitchell, he's also dealing with a hamstring injury as well. And he's been injury prone as well. He hasn't played. Yeah. This is going to be his third year. I don't think he's finished a year so far. And even then, it's not like he's the starter to take, you know, the handful of impacts that a normal running back would. So, I mean, I personally would probably skip over Elijah Mitchell and go over to Jordan Mason, personally, if I was to pick for a handcuff. But, I mean, it's crazy that, you know, while they do have 8 running backs on that roster, when Christian McCaffrey starts, I think he plays like 95% of the snaps.
Yeah,
he is the only true bell cow left in the NFL. And honestly, in my personal opinion, I would Tip says Bijan Robinson. He's 101. I'm sorry. Even if he has like a hurt calf, I'm still probably taking McCaffrey.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. Now let's also move on to we're going to stay on the Niners and we're going to talk about Brandon Ayuk real fast.
Oh, yeah.
I know he's an interesting topic of discussion right now. Mm-hmm. And if he gets traded, I wouldn't touch him with a 10-foot pole. But that would significantly raise my personal opinion. Actually, we might have to talk about him more in depth. Ricky Pearsall, wide receiver, round 1 in the most recent draft taken. But he just re-aggravated a shoulder injury that he had in the offseason. If Brandon Ayuk, hypothetically speaking, if Brandon Ayuk does get traded, are you more interested in Deebo Samuel, Ricky Pearsall, or any type of wide receiver weapons? We'll start with you, Tip.
Definitely interested in Deebo because Deebo is what makes, well, besides McCaffrey, it's what makes the wide receiver engine go. So I definitely would be higher on Deebo, but Debo's getting up there in age too.
Mm-hmm. So what about George Kittle?
Receiver room. That's what I was going to say. George Kittle is a guy that, 100%. I think that George Kittle would be the guy in the pass game because Deebo can do it all. So I think that George Kittle would be the guy. I mean, you talked about Ricky Pearsall, but, you know, he also has this – you know, it's crazy. San Francisco always gets snake-bitten by some of these injuries. it's like they're one of those teams where you're just like, man, they can't buy a break. And it always comes at the worst time. Like, for instance, with the Christian McCaffrey, it's coming at a really bad time because it's at the beginning of the season. But I digress. So, I think that the wide receiver room there, and the name is blanking me right now, and I'm about to pull it up.
Juwan Jennings.
Juwan Jennings, yes. That is a guy. Juwan Jennings is a guy that I was looking. I was looking at before all of this stuff had happened, and because of the physical fact that he had a really strong postseason. I mean, he was making plays all over the field in the Super Bowl. If the Niners would have won, he probably could have gotten the MVP award. So I look at a guy like Juwan Jennings. I look at a guy like Juwan Jennings right now, and I'm drafting him because we don't know what the Brandon Ayuk situation is. You got Debo, who's a little older. If Brandon Ayuk is gone, then yes, you absolutely get Juwan Jennings because they showed in the playoffs and sometimes in the season, his target totals are really low. He doesn't get a lot of field quite a bit too, but blocking doesn't equate to points. But, you know, he still will be a guy who will be on the field. And if Brandon Ayuk is gone, I think that, you know, Juwan Jennings will be the person I will go with.
Yeah, I guess for me, I just look at the situation. Let's start with Brandon Ayuk. I would not want to target Brandon Ayuk in fantasy drafts right now, given his average draft position, especially if he's going to be on a new team, because there's no guarantee that he would get the targets. I have been really fascinated with Debo Samuel really all summer. You know, because of the Ayuk uncertainty, I'm like, his ADP has been very favorable. And you look back to Debo last year, I'm like, his 9 yards after the catch per reception last year actually ranked first among qualified wide receivers. And we know how dynamic he is as a receiver, but also as a runner, you know, when he gets those handoffs, even with the Christian McCaffrey that's there. I really wouldn't be, like, with Ricky Purcell, I'm like, on the surface, it sounds like a good, like, opportunity. But I would prefer Samuel, and you mentioned George Kittle too. And that's someone that I'm really fascinated with when you look at his average draft position because he's essentially free, like in drafts. And so what I'm finding is that if I miss out on a guy like Travis Kelce, I'm very comfortable just waiting to get Kittle. So, you know, let me explain, you know, why he's my kind of go-to tight end late.
Hit it.
One thing with the 49ers, they've got a ton of playmakers. We've been talking about that, all the names. But you look at Kittle. I'm like, he had a career high in yards per target last year at 11.3. You know, he had 15.7 yards per reception last year. And he had 7 games of 16 or more fantasy points. But he also had 6 games of 6 or fewer points. So there is some volatility that's there. But here's the reality. The tight end position has always been volatile, unless you have like a Travis Kelce or even perhaps going into this year like a Sam Laporta. But I'm very comfortable with that volatility with Kittle, with building a roster like around him, considering where you're drafting him. So he could end up seeing more of those targets if Brandon Ayuk does end up leaving. And let's say instead of a guy like Kittle, like over the last 5 seasons, he's only averaged 6.5 targets. What if we had a guy like Kittle get 8.5 or 9 targets? Just think about the ceiling he would have in that scenario.
Exactly. I mean, there's a lot of playmakers specifically on this Niners team. I know we talked about, you know, Juwan Jennings, Ricky Purcell. There's still Danny Gray that they drafted not that long ago, I believe 2 years ago. There's still Ronnie Bell, who had a phenomenal preseason, but he just got depth chart squashed. And, you know, even in games where I should say the Brandon Ayuk did not play, or it was Debo Samuel, unfortunately, did not play. I think it was a Monday night against the Giants where he had a majority of the snaps and he ended up snagging a touchdown catch in itself. So, I mean, there's a lot of playmakers on this Niners team, which is why I feel like I feel like a lot of us understand why the Niners don't want to significantly throw away that salary cap on Brandon Ayuk. But, I mean, is there any team, Mr. Eric, that you would be interested in Brandon Ayuk if he was to go on a specific team?
Yeah, I would say the Steelers is one that would be fascinating because, you know, you're going to have – I just love to see Justin Fields, like, as the starter with that team instead of Russell Wilson. He's kind of let us down the past 2 seasons as I was getting older. But I'm just thinking about if you add, like, a Brandon Ayuk to that team, like, I think would even help, like, George Pickens, who we don't know if he's capable of being the number one guy yet, right? You know, we don't know how he's going to handle, you know, that pressure. So – I would really like to see Ayuk land with a team like the Steelers. I've heard rumors of what about the Browns too, right? People were talking about the Browns today.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't think that would be good. That would be disastrous. You know, they got Jerry Jeudy there and you've got Amari Cooper. They're going to command a ton of targets. So I would say if I had to pick a team where I would like him to go to, if he does get traded, I would go with the Steelers. But I would just like to see him stay in San Francisco. If he wants to win a championship, that's going to be his best chance to do so. I just don't think he's going to be able to win one necessarily with the Steelers. That's just my opinion.
Tip?
Yeah. So the Browns, from what, because when this came out last night, I was like, what is going on? The Browns and the Patriots? And if he goes to the Patriots, forget about it. Just forget about it this year. I'm almost to the point, if he goes to the Patriots, he's off my board completely. I'm not going to touch him. I'm not doing it. But if he does go to the Browns, what I did hear is that it could be Amari Cooper for him straight up, and then a couple of draft picks for I think it was Cleveland or one of the teams get draft picks. So anyway, so if that happens, I would be intrigued in that situation. Brandon Ayuk is a really good route runner. He's, you know, really good hands as well. So I think that it would take time. Obviously, you got to learn a new offense. And, you know, the other thing about the offense in Cleveland is that it's an intricate offense. So he's going from one intricate offense to another one. And if he does that, I think it's going to take some time, but I would be intrigued with him, especially in a dynasty format. I would try to go after him in dynasty, because if he becomes the number one over there and you have Jared Jeudy as well, I still think that Brandon Ayuk would be the number one guy eventually. It might take half the season, but once that part comes into fruition, it's on. So I think that would be intriguing.
All right, to wrap a bow on it, I mean, personally, I don't blame him for wanting to leave the Niners if he does, considering, one, he's going to have to take a little bit of a pay cut in order to stay there, and two, God, California taxes are something else. I don't blame him for wanting to go to a place with less taxes. But all right, another player that, you know, let's move off of the Niners. I heard enough of them. But staying in that division right now, we got Puka Nacua. And I always tell people, you know, Puka Nacua is Samoan for Jerry Rice. But how do we feel about him and his injury right now, Mr. Eric?
Yeah, it's I'll be frank. It's like, one thing about Puka, just given his average draft position, he's been someone that I've really been avoiding, like, in drafts, because he did have some injuries last year. Let me see if my memory serves right. He had a AC sprain, I believe, that he was dealing with last year. Had like a hip situation. He was able to play through that. But this, you know, a right knee injury, that's just not a good injury to have, like, in the preseason leading up to the season, especially with that, you know, quotations week to week. So I just think he's really risky just given his average draft position. And I find myself more often picking up Cooper Kupp, who I think is a really nice value at his average draft position right now. And we know the rapport that Cooper Kupp has with Matthew Stafford. And because of that, in drafts, I've been targeting Cooper Kupp, like, heavily. I know in the ESPN mock draft that we've been doing, I think I've probably snagged Cooper Kupp in probably like close to 35 to 40% of those 40 or so drafts that we've done. So I'm a huge, huge guy. I'll leave you with this stat, too, is that one thing with Kupp is that he's had like a 30% target share in games played over the last three seasons. That's like the second highest in the league, like, over that span. So just go get Cooper Kupp.
I like Cooper Kupp a lot. Now, Mr. Tip, are you still interested in Puka? Now, I real quick, I want to add that I think with Puka that we're drafting him at a ceiling right now. And whenever that happens, we're always going to be left to be disappointed. But Tip, how do you feel?
Yeah, Eric just said, you know, when you have an injury this early in the season, you got to deal with that all season. I don't care how it's something that, especially like with these knee injuries, soft tissue injury, those things can linger for a majority of the season. We saw Joe Burrow last year say, "I'm 100%, I'm good, I'm back," and then now he's dealing with a wrist injury. So it's something. There's always different ailments that you can run into. So I am out on Puka right now because I do agree that Cooper Kupp is healthy. They already have the rapport. The only issue was the health. There was no other issue with Cooper Kupp other than health. That's it. So now you have a healthy Cooper Kupp, and Matthew Stafford trusts him. Now, another guy is DeMarcus Robinson. I think you go out there. If you weren't already, you should have already, most likely, he should have been gone in drafts anyway, but you might want to check the waiver wires out there for someone like DeMarcus Robinson. I've already checked waiver wires, and most of the leagues that I'm in, he's gone. I think I got him in one. But yeah, it's a guy that I'm looking at.
Yeah, I mean, that would be a good roster stash in itself. Now, I'm going to lightning round a couple players. Just give me a yay or nay if you feel comfortable with their situation or if the players around them get affected. Like, for example, Justin Herbert right now with a foot injury, considered week to week in a walking boot.
At first, I'd say nay on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
nay. Nay? All right. Let's go with... Okay, DeAndre Hopkins.
Nay.
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 Elijah Moore.
You sounded like a bunch of horses.
I know, right?
Elijah Moore.
Ooh. I'll say nay.
Nay. No, I like the Jordan. I'd like the Jordan Mason call. Nadir.
Uh-huh. Kadarius Toney.
You're going to get a hell no out of me. I'm sorry. Nay. Forget the nay. You got hell no.
I'm laughing because I was like, we really going there? We're really going there? We're really going there. Right.
I drafted. I got to.
I know.
Wow. Do you really?
Just for fun. I sometimes I got to see you guys smile every so often. All right. We're going to transition real fast to the miniature mock draft that we got going on. So right now, I'm going to tell everybody, first tip, read the settings. All right, like, if you're joining draft, make sure you understand the rules and the draft setup of the team and the roster size, of course. So right now, this is a 10-man. I can switch it to 12 if you guys want. I don't know if it really matters too much, but it is a 2 wide receiver, 2 running back, 1 flex, 1 QB, tight end, you know, yada, 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 and all that stuff. But we're not going to be going that far anyway for it to matter. But half one PPR, more importantly. But right now, I kind of actually appreciate you guys. All right, Mr. Tip, he already went 101. Moody, you went last pick. And I just went to the middle just because I was like, all right, I'll add some variety to it. I really appreciate you guys doing that. I didn't have to ask or anything. Hey, kudos to you guys for that. Now, since you guys are both on the corners, I always like to ask, when you are on the corners, what is your personal preference for draft strategy? Because let's face it, like right now, Mr. Eric at 10, you're going to probably be taking somebody like, you know, like Breece Hall, AJ Brown, Gibbs, Garrett Wilson, Puka Nacua, all that stuff. But you have the second pick to turn. And because of that, you know, if you don't take, for example, Jonathan Taylor or Saquon Barkley, he's not coming back to you. Or, you know, I'll stretch a little bit. Marvin Harrison Jr. Say you really want Marvin Harrison Jr., but, you know, he's not coming back to you. He's going to be gone by the time he comes back. There's going to be 24 or 20 picks till you pick again. So are you going to reach for a person that you specifically want, or are you going to sit there and settle on, okay, you know what, Jahmyr Gibbs' ADP is right here. This is about when I should be drafting him. I'm going to take him.
Yeah, in many of those scenarios, I would just end up just really taking what the draft is giving me. Like I wouldn't pass on a guy like Jahmyr Gibbs. You know, if Saquon Barkley's there, Jonathan Taylor, you have to take those players. I just really let positional tiers kind of guide the way for me, just depending on how others draft. I just think it's important to really monitor the supply and demand of all the positions as you go through the draft. And to your point, I'm like, you know, you're not going to be back on the clock for quite some time. It feels like an eternity when you're in a live draft, whenever you're waiting. So I just think if you do have like the 10 or the 11th or 12th spot in a 10 to 12 team league, I really think you've got to go like running back and like wide receiver there just to kind of have that balance. That's my opinion.
Yeah. Mr. Tip, how do you feel about that?
Yeah, I like that. I think that is when you, for people who are a zero RB theorist, that's when you can go ahead and try to do running back, wide receiver, or wide receiver, running back, because you're going to have potentially the best of both, you know, positions. You could luck out and really, like, I've been in some leagues and lucked out and got Bijan Robinson and Justin Jefferson, like back to back, and those guys could literally finish top in each position if all the stars align. So that is in and of itself is crazy. So yeah, I like that strategy.
There we go in that in itself. All right. So right now, let's just do it. We're going to be talking about who we're taking, who we don't want, why we're taking that specific person. Nothing too crazy. It'll be a nice chill time. I'll pause it, you know, when we guys want to speak and all that stuff to make sure that we don't overtake our time. And then it, you know, just lets somebody auto draft for us. But then in itself, Mr. Tip, you're currently on the clock at 101.
Bijan Robinson. Draft.
You know, the problem is I'm going to manually select Christian McCaffrey for you. So you can do that because I know you want to do that.
Look, if this doesn't solidify it for me taking Bijan Robinson over Christian McCaffrey, I'll give you more reasons. He has one of the top O-lines. I know Christian McCaffrey has a good O-line too, but he has one of the top O-lines. He plays indoors. He's playing with a way better quarterback than he's ever played with. He's got weapons on the outside that'll take pressure away, won't stack the boxes. Look at what Zach Robinson did last year with Kyren Williams. And you're telling me he can't do that with Bijan Robinson, a first-round pick versus a fifth-round pick? Kyren Williams is great. I love Kyren Williams. But Bijan Robinson, he, to me, has a potential to be a Christian McCaffrey light. I'm not going to say Christian man, but a Christian McCaffrey light. He can take over the league.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to sit there and blame you for that logic, right? I'm not going to blame you for wanting Bijan Robinson. He has a lot going for him right now, but he has a lot of hype.
You took Christian McCaffrey. Hold on. No,
I manually select Christian McCaffrey for you, by the way. I just want, that's why, like, in the background, I was laughing because I did that for you. I thought it was funny.
That is funny. she did it.
Because, like, so, I mean, he has a lot going for him, but there's a lot of hype with that. And usually hype of that caliber never comes to fruition. Like, the stars are aligning. This is going to happen. This is going to happen. And then it's going to put him in the promise. It never ends up really happening. Like, I'm trying to think, AV, think of a time where the stars aligned for a player and it actually happened. I can't really think of one other than potentially Christian McCaffrey, but we already knew Christian McCaffrey was a beast. He was a beast for the Panthers. He just happened to be an even bigger beast for the Niners.
The stars aligned for Adrian Peterson. The stars aligned for Christian, for Cooper Kupp when he hit the triple crown.
And I've got something I can add to that. Like, I understand Tip's, like, excitement, like, with Bijan Robinson, because I know you've got Arthur Smith, who's no longer in Atlanta. You know, he's with the Steelers. They've got Zach Robinson that's there, who's got a history with Sean McVay and the Rams. You know, so he's going to be their offensive coordinator. And he's really surrounded himself, like, with a great staff of, like, veteran, like, offensive coaches to assist. But I just look at, like, Kyren Williams, like, from last year, because we know McVay loves to focus just on one running back. And we saw Robinson only have, I think, 47.5% of the rushing attempts last year, but really excelled as a receiver. But I just look at the volume that Williams had last year, 21.7 touches and 21.2 fantasy points per game. That kind of gives you an idea of what Bijan Robinson is capable of, but he's a much more explosive and even more dynamic player than Kyren Williams. So that's what really gets me excited. And just to kind of close the loop on that, I know we talked about one, player who, where everything kind of, like, aligned. It really made me think about it. What was that back in, 2014, I think? 2013 to 2014 with, like, DeMarco Murray? Because I remember he was, like, a late second-round, third-round pick. And I remember, like, he was, like, a league winner because he definitely exceeded expectations. They gave him the volume. We knew from a dynasty lens, it's like, yeah, this guy's going to be cooked at the end of the season. But we all remember what he did. If you had him in redraft, you were very happy with the result.
Very happy with that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So, okay, right now, Christian McCaffrey being 101, we have Tyreek Hill, Ja'Marr Chase, and CeeDee Lamb right after that, followed by Justin Jefferson. Mr. Eric, are you okay with this order, or how would you personally preference it?
Well, the one thing that really, just looking at sleepers ADP, because I know in ESPN leagues, if you were just following, like, the ADP, Jefferson is going, like, in the later part of the first round, like 8 or 9. So I think that's one thing that's really, really surprising. But Tip's going to love this. Can't wait to see his expression. But I just think that you can easily take, like, Bijan and feel good about it, like, anywhere from that 4 to 6 range.
Yeah, that part I'm not going to disagree with you.
Yeah.
I think he is a phenomenal pick. in that 4-6 range, just not 101. Sorry, Tim.
Yeah, yeah, not more, more so like if you have him in the middle rounds. But yeah, I think everything is good so far. Okay. I know Breece Hall is one of those guys in ESPN leagues that's kind of ranked around this range if you were going just from an ADP lens. But looks fine to me. It looks like chalk, you know.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Mr. Tip, how would you rank the wide receivers right now? So, like these four right here that are on the board: Tyreek Hill, Chase, Lamb, Jefferson. Which one would you prefer out of the four? And then continue on that list.
It's got to be Tyreek. I mean, he's as safe as they come. He has so many ceiling weeks. It's crazy. The other three are great. Justin Jefferson, it would probably be number two after that. Ja'Marr Chase. I know Ja'Marr Chase would be there too, but he's got contractual situations that he's going through. Same with CeeDee Lamb. But yeah, it's still got to be Tyreek, man. Still, Tyreek's easy, clear cut.
So personally, I think I might go, if I were to rank him, I'd go Tyreek Hill, followed very closely by CeeDee Lamb. And then Ja'Marr Chase and Justin Jefferson, mostly just because Joe Burrow can't seem to stay healthy. And I'm also with Moody, where the questionable quarterback play for the Vikings might hamper his production. But Moody, how do you feel about that?
Yeah, we know the targets will be there for Justin Jefferson. And to your point with Burrow, I'm like, if we get 17 games of Joe Burrow and Ja'Marr Chase, you know, I easily see Ja'Marr Chase. Like he's the type of player I would say that I think it's in play for him to finish potentially as like the wide receiver one, but maybe even overall like the best player like in fantasy. And I guess I'll do like a little bit of a plug. Like I've got a column that's coming out tomorrow about the guys that I'm targeting heavily in fantasy drafts. And really the only, I would say, first round ADP type of guy that I mentioned was Ja'Marr Chase. And I built a pretty compelling case like as the why. I'll kind of give you a sneak preview and leave you with this. His slot usage, like running routes from the slot, when you look at his contemporaries, Tyreek Hill, CeeDee Lamb, the Justin Jeffersons of the world, it's been relatively lower than those players. And you've got Tyler Boyd that's no longer on this team, who really hogged a lot of the routes from the slot since he's been in Cincinnati. I think they're going to try to pivot and give some of those to Ja'Marr Chase. So I'm like, he's been really productive. If you look at the games that he's had with Joe Burrow, I forgot how many fantasy points off the top of my head that he's averaged. I know it's between like 20 to 22 fantasy points per game, but I just think if you get like a healthy Burrow, I'm like, he's going to be like a monster. And he was on pace, I think like last year during the first five games, I think the average like seven receptions and I think like 90 or so like receiving yards. He's basically on pace for like 16 to 1700 yards. It's kind of what I'm trying to get at. Yeah. So, I really like Chase, but anyway, I don't want to go too far down that rabbit hole. So.
Oh, yeah. It's definitely a rabbit hole with him. There's no denying the production of Joe Burrow and Ja'Marr Chase, but it's the does Joe Burrow play a full 17 games? Historically, he hasn't done that. So that's the only reason why he kind of slips down that. But all right, right now, I am available at the sixth pick of the draft, and of course with me right now available is Bijan Robinson, Amon Ross St. Brown, and AJ Brown. And I mean, realistically the proper pick here is Bijan Robinson. You take him because, one, he is a potential bell cow running back sixth pick, which is in theory a good idea. He has a lot going for him, as Tip mentioned earlier and in the previous episodes, as he does love Bijan Robinson. There's no issue with taking him. Like Eric said, between the one and the four and the six, phenomenal pick. The only reason why I would take Amon Ross St. Brown is, one, I'm a big fan of him. I like him a lot. Two, he has a really cool name. And that's almost all you need necessarily to pick somebody. So I'm not going to fault anybody for that. But of course, I'm going to be the one that takes Bijan Robinson. I think this is kind of funny. He's going to be the guy that I want to take. And I mean, it's kind of self-explanatory at that moment. Here, I'll pause the draft for you, Mr. Eric. You are on the clock. So, I mean, Bijan, he's taken. Breece Hall, taken right after that. Gibbs, right after that at the pick eight. And then Brown.
That's very surprising.
That is very surprising.
Ja'Marr Gibbs right there. So yeah. I've been given a gift, and you know, let me explain. So I'm going to go Amon Ross St. Brown here.
Yes. Talk about it.
Seeing him available is crazy. Let me try to load up the window.
Let me resume the draft
for you. Yeah, you can unpause it and I can click. So we're going to go with Amon-Ra St. Brown back on the clock again. And, you know, again, we had the conversation about Puka Nacua and some of my concerns there. But I'm looking and seeing, like, Garrett Wilson that's there. Like, I feel confident, like, in the middle rounds, there's a lot of running backs there that I like that are RB2 types that can easily exceed expectations. So what I would end up doing here, I'm thinking about going, like, with Garrett Wilson. But I'm looking at, like, Jonathan Taylor there. You're thinking about him in the, like, in the second round or Barkley. I'm going to have to go with one of those other guys. So I'll probably end up going with Jonathan Taylor here.
So I have it paused for a second. Oh, I do want to ask you.
Okay, yeah.
Are you making this decision to go – sorry, did you say you're going Saquon Barkley?
Yeah, I was looking at Jonathan Taylor or Saquon here just to kind of solidify, you know, like a running back. Again, I do like the running backs that are available, like, in the middle rounds. But again, I don't know what's going to happen when we go through the rest of the second round and then into the third round before I get back, like, on the clock again. And so just as a kind of contingency plan, like, I would just want to go with like a running back here. But I'm also really thinking about Garrett Wilson there as well, you know, just to really have two elite wide receiver one kind of alphas on my team, though.
Now, do you feel forced to take a running back right now?
I wouldn't say I feel forced, because if we look at the running backs that will probably be available by the time I'm back on the clock, like, I'll be perfectly fine with a guy like Alvin Kamara. If I go with Garrett Wilson, and I've done that before in some of the ESPN mock drafts where we've done the 10-team leagues, where I'll go with like a Garrett Wilson and, you know, like a – I'm trying to think of some of the other players, but basically kind of two elite, like, wide receivers, and then go – with like an Alvin Kamara, like, is my RB1, and then follow that up with a guy like Aaron Jones if I'm at the turn. You know, there's just so many options. You got Zamir White that's there. You know, you got Tony Pollard, Tajay Spears. You've got a lot of guys that are available that can give you RB2 production, but they do have RB1 upside in certain matchups. So, okay. I wouldn't say necessarily Forrest, but I'm kind of curious just to see. I'll go with Wilson, and I want to see who's available. And I'll take my first running back at the end of the third round. So we'll kind of see how it turns out.
Okay. Now, quick, right before I hit resume. Picks 7 and 8 were running backs. Breece Hall and Jahmyr Gibbs. Do you feel like that's a mistake?
The one that I feel like is kind of a mistake, but it's just kind of early, would be like Jahmyr Gibbs. Because, you know, I'm thinking, you know, I've got ESPN's ADP like ingrained in my head. He's kind of going at the top half of, like, the second round. I feel like Breece Hall's a pretty good value there. But Gibbs, I would just rather be able to snag Gibbs, like, in the second round. If I have Amon-Ra St. Brown at the 110 and at the turn, you know, I'm back on the clock at the top of the second round and Gibbs is there, I would seriously consider going Gibbs. But you've also got Barkley that's there. You know, the volume will be there. And you also have Jonathan Taylor too, and some people may be turned off by those running backs because they do have quarterbacks who are mobile and do accumulate rushing yards. But I just, you know, I think they're still two solid picks. You should feel good about having either one of those guys like as your RB1. So I may even consider going with Barkley or Taylor over a guy like Gibbs, because you still have Monty there, David Montgomery in Detroit. So
now tips, just so you can have a little moment here to shine. You're in the 7th or 8th pick. You're going either like AJ Brown or Amon-Ra St. Brown, or are you going with what's happened right now, which would be like Breece Hall, Gibbs, or another player?
No, I'm going to Amon-Ra.
Amon-Ra?
Yeah. Gotta take him.
Yeah, I think if he's on the board, especially at 7+. Yeah, 7+. If Amon-Ra's on the board, you gotta take him. Yep. AJ Brown. I almost want to say he's a must follow after that, but you know, just because if Breece Hall's available, you might want to take Breece Hall to secure a running back. I'm not going to blame anybody for that.
Yeah, I would say two stats real quick for because this is an interesting scenario. So if Amon-Ra St. Brown's available late, I'll leave you with this. Last year, most games with 100 plus receiving yards last season, he had 9. He also had 13 games with 15 or more fantasy points. Last year that was tied for the most among wide receivers in fantasy. So you just got to take them and move on. Don't question it. Just do it. You can thank Tip and I later.
Amon-Ra is going to be that guy for you. All right, let me unpause it so you can make your second pick. So that's going to wrap up the first round of that. I think that was a really interesting one with a lot of talking points, which is kind of what we were going for specifically on this one. So I'm actually pretty glad that the scenario ended up happening. It just gave us a lot more talking point and it break down a lot more than what I honestly anticipated, which I really appreciate. Thank you, Sleeper, for doing that. So right after that, Garrett Wilson got taken by Mr. Moody with his second pick. And after that, Puka Nacua got taken. Honestly, I don't have any concerns, not concerns, but like I don't have any complaints about that. Saquon Barkley right after that as well. Drake London. I personally don't like that, but I don't know how you guys feel about Drake London being taken in the second round.
Yeah, you know, I'm a huge fan of like this Falcons offense this year with, you know, with Kirk Cousins, new regime, you know, the whole nine. But Drake London's ADP has been bothering me. I would prefer to have him like in the third round. It's just not happening. But the upside is potentially there because you look at Kirk Cousins, even during his time like with the Vikings, if you look at what his number one receiver like was able to do, like very good fantasy production. I think they average around, like 9 targets and 18 fantasy points per game. But you're essentially drafting like Drake London, like kind of like at almost at a ceiling, like in a way, you know, he's doesn't really have much margin for error drafting him that high, but right. That's just kind of my initial thoughts.
Mm-hmm. Just like I feel like Drake London is just like Bijan Robinson to Puka Nacua. Mm-hmm. You're drafting maybe not Puka because he already has the production to prove it, but you're drafting him for what he could be and what his potential upside is, not necessarily what he has done. And for that, I feel like it's very difficult to take somebody that early that isn't a running back in this case. Now I'm currently on the board and honestly, nobody really stands out to me as somebody I'm like, oh, I really got to have that guy on my roster right now.
Well, I hope he comes to me because I see somebody
right now.
Yeah, me too.
Right now available is Jonathan Taylor, Marvin Harrison Jr., Kyren Williams, Devontae Adams, Travis Etienne, Josh Allen, stuff like that. After that, I feel like, you know, I lose the value in the pick, but I kind of have to decide, do I want a wide receiver or do I want another running back? Because at this point, I feel like I could get a wide receiver in the third round and in the fourth round to kind of solidify it and make me feel at least pretty confident that, you know, I left the draft with some good wide receivers. And then all I have to do is decide, do I want Jonathan Taylor or Kyren Williams? They are probably the two best running back options available. Ooh, this is where I'm actually going to ask for some advice. Eric, what do you think?
Yeah, I would end up going with Jonathan Taylor here. You know, we know that you got Anthony Richardson that's there. You know, he's obviously going to accumulate some passing attempts, but I think they're going to lean heavily on the running game. And it's going to help a guy like Taylor with having Richardson there, who's obviously a rushing threat. So you really can't go wrong in that scenario. You got Bijan as your RB1, Jonathan Taylor as your RB2. You can string together some wide receivers. So I really like how that team's coming together.
That is not his pick, Bijan. Let's make it clear. He stole my pick.
He's on my right. He's on my team right now.
He's
on my team. I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah.
So why Jonathan over Kyren?
Let's see how I can sell this. One thing with Taylor, and I know Kyren's coming off the big year. I know he did kind of deal with some injury woes. Same thing with Taylor, but what I liked about Taylor is that I felt like he kind of had a down year, even though he still averaged, 15.6 fantasy points per game last year, which was 11th amongst running backs with 150 or more rushing attempts. But one thing that really sticks with me is that, 74% of his PPR fantasy points were through rushing attempts. That was the 6th highest amongst running backs last season. So some people are concerned about Anthony Richardson as a passer, but I always look at a guy like Taylor just thinking, hey, if he's just getting the rushing attempts, he's still going to produce. He's not one of those guys where you're like, he needs the targets or the receptions to reach his ceiling. So that's what I kind of like with Taylor. It's like a bonus if he does get those targets. Mm-hmm. So that's why I just feel a little bit more comfortable with Taylor rather than Kyren Williams.
Tip, how do you feel about that real fast?
Yeah, with Kyren Williams, you have Blake Corum there. And I know Eric said that Sean McVay usually likes to use one running back. Well, he tried that last year with, you know, Cam Akers. Cam Akers got banged up. Then Kyren Williams came in. He got banged up. So he might try to deploy, because trust me, you don't, well, they don't have Daryl Henderson anymore, but whoever their third running back is, he doesn't want to have to go that route again. So they go and get Blake Corum, and I think that's the reason why I would go Jonathan Taylor.
Yeah, he's going to be involved. He's going to have, yeah, definitely.
You know what? I'm going to listen to you guys. I'll take Jonathan Taylor.
All right, now I'm talking about my guy here. I'm like, Devontae Adams is being like overlooked, which is,
oh boy,
is blowing my mind. Like, he's another guy that I find myself rostering like often.
Had, yes,
33.3% target percentage like last year, first in the league. 41% team red zone target percentage too. It's just like, I know he's older, but I'm just like, getting him like in the third or even fourth rounds in some leagues, you know, it's just, it can happen. Third round's kind of the sweet spot, but definitely take him as your wide receiver one if you go running back in drafts. So I don't know. I have to say it.
If he does come back to me, I'll probably end up taking it. But the problem is he had a high target percentage. There we go. That's the word. The problem is that it was such a bad quality of targets. Like, there was a bunch of overthrows, underthrows, inaccurate passes. They don't have a quarterback. And if Minshew's the best that they got, I might look at somebody like, you know, for example, if Brandon Ayuk was to sign the extension, I'd probably rather go Brandon Ayuk. I'd rather probably go Marvin Harrison probably isn't going to be there, obviously, but
yeah,
somebody like Nico Collins. I don't know. It's so hard. Actually, Nico Collins is probably too late now. I don't know. After getting burned from him last year, like, maybe there's a little bit of a sour taste in my mouth. But like you said, if he does make it to the sixth round in the middle of it, I don't think I have a choice but to take him.
Well, wait, time out. You felt like you got burned by Devontae Adams, who had 103 catches, over 1,100 yards, 8 touchdowns. That's production. And now I do understand. I will say this. There was a big time difference between the first part of the season towards the end of the season.
That's where
But guess what? Those two idiots that were, and I'm a Raiders fan, so I'm going to call them idiots. Those two idiots that are no longer there, Jimmy G and Josh McDaniel, are gone. And we saw Devontae Adams build a rapport with Aiden O'Connell. We saw that happen. He vouched for Aiden O'Connell. I think that this is a situation where Eric is actually right. I don't know why he's still on the board, because I would be, if he comes to me, I would be happy as him. If I go running back, which I am looking at it now, this season, you can actually do that and still have a really good wide receiver one like a Devontae Adams.
Yeah.
In weeks 5 through 9, in PPR, he's had 8.5, 4.9, 12.7, 2.1.
And that's rough.
And 7.4. His good games were in the fantasy playoffs. If you had Devontae Adams, you didn't make it into the fantasy playoffs.
Yeah. it turned around once like Antonio Pierce got there, because they're just like, hey, let's just get the ball, you know, in our
they knew what to do with him.
Yeah.
And it's not like Josh McDaniels did not try to get Devontae Adams the ball. It's Jimmy G, for whatever reason, was very inaccurate. Like, I would cringe watching those videos. No, I just said I could see why Devontae Adams was so upset at the beginning of the receiver show on Netflix, because he had Jimmy G throwing him the ball.
Jimmy G.
If you think Devontae Adams was upset, how do you think us felt? We're more important.
It was us.
We had him in fantasy. We're more important. How do you think we felt? We felt worse. Like,
it seems to me like you just bitter because that was your number one.
I'm bitter. I said earlier, maybe I'm just salty. Got burned by him last year. Yeah, no, I'm bitter.
Okay.
I'm bitter. Last year, I had a draft where I left with it was my two wide receivers was Garrett Wilson and Devontae Adams. I thought I won the league.
Ooh. Oh, with, wow.
Yeah, yeah. I got last place.
That did not go as planned.
No, it did not. All right. So after my pick of Jonathan Taylor, we got Chris Olave. How do you feel about Chris Olave real fast? Just a quick, give me a quickie on him.
Yeah, I feel good about him, especially where he's going. I'm like, he's the third receiver in Saints history, with over 2,000 receiving yards in his first two seasons. Joins like Michael Thomas and Marquise Colton. So pretty good company. So I like Chris Olave.
Yeah, all right. Sounds good. Travis Etienne after that. I'm not going to complain about that either. Like, he's solid running back, solid pick in a solid spot. After that, let me hit resume so we can get to Tips pick. After that, Davante Adams has been taken off the board. Sorry, sir. You will not be able to take him. After that, you got sniped again with Kyren Williams. Okay, wow. You just got, in my opinion, I think you got double sniped, because if Davante Adams was gone, I think you would have taken Kyren Williams. So you got double sniped in that moment. Wow. Right now, Mr. Tip is on the board. I'll let you break it down for us.
I'm going to go another running back, and this running back should have a good year. He's older, but he should have a good year. I'm going Derrick Henry.
That is a little bit of a, I'm not going to say a reach.
You said a half point PPR, right?
This is half point PPR.
Half point PPR. You know he's going to get touches. He's going to get goal line looks. I think the sky's the limit for Derrick Henry. The biggest thing, again, is health, guys. That's what it is with this guy.
So what makes it so you're taking Derrick Henry over, for example, either like Josh Jacobs, Devon Achane, or even another wide receiver, Marvin Harrison, because you already have Christian McCaffrey.
Yeah, I mean, look, as far as wide receivers go, Marvin Harrison is, yes, but did you see that little R next to him?
Yeah, it's a rookie
symbol.
The little rookie.
I'm maybe just a little bit biased against Ruben. And I know that, look, Marvin Harrison is supposed to be phenomenal, right? But the thing is, there's going to be growing pains. There's going to be a situation where he is not used to the speed of this game, because it is different than college, or the hits that he might endure. So it's going to take a little bit of time. Now, if we were talking dynasty, if this was a dynasty draft, no brainer. I'm picking Marvin Harrison, and I'm probably picking Malik Nabers next after that. But this is a half point PPR. I'm going to go running back, man. I'm going to stick with the guns. I'm going to go running back. I like Josh Jacobs, but I think Josh Jacobs would actually be the reach. Because I just think that Derrick Henry is going to get the volume, and he's going to get the volume early in the season.
Mm-hmm. That's a fair point. I'm not going to knock any of that, because a lot of the times touchdowns equal about 4 points, roughly 4 points more than a reception. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to eclipse touchdowns over receptions, then I'm going to agree with you. Derrick Henry would be the guy to pick at that moment. Now, I just want to put it out there. Hypothetically speaking, right now, Brandon Ayuk re-signed with the Niners. Because I know his ADP is coming up and his pick is going to be coming up. And right now we're just going to hypothetically say that he re-signed with the Niners.
I don't know if I can trust you because you took Christian McCaffrey when I picked Bijan Robinson.
No, you took Christian McCaffrey. It says literally right there, Christian McCaffrey 101. I don't know what you're talking about.
All right. Let me get Derrick Henry.
And now you're on the clock again.
Okay. All right. So this is where there's some decision time, decisions to be made. I like the wide receivers that are in front of me. Marvin Harrison, Brandon Ayuk, Nico Collins. The guy I would really, really, really heavily look at here, though, would be Mike Evans. Because out of those other three, besides Brandon Ayuk, they all have people that I feel like could take some other targets. And I know they got Chris Godwin there, but Mike Evans has proved year in and year out that he's the guy. But he is getting older. What is this, his 10th season in the league? They don't have Dave Canales anymore either, guys. Oof, that makes me nervous, because there's going to be growing pains within this offense. So I'm going to go Isaiah Pacheco next. I want three running backs in this
three running league. Backs.
I want three running backs, because I can get, with those three running backs, I'm going to get pass catches. Supposed to be Bijan, but Christian McCaffrey. I'm going to get pass catches from Isaiah Pacheco. He proved last year that he can catch passes as well. And I'm getting in all these guys are in high-powered offenses, or what are seemed to be high-powered offenses. So there's really good chances these guys are going to get touchdowns. So that's where I went with that. And then now I know we're not doing the fourth. Now I can focus on receiving threats.
Okay, so if this was like an actual league, I'd be salty at you right now for hoarding the running backs. But from a strategical standpoint, no, it's a really good idea. Hoard the running backs. But you did fill up your right now, your running backs, your two RBs, and your flex. Assuming that, you know, Pacheco will probably occupy your flex. But if you're drafting him in the third round, chances are you already have an idea that he's going to be occupying your flex. What you also did is you gave yourself the ability, one, for an injury, that you're still able to fill up your running back slots. Two, bye weeks. Bye weeks is what a lot of people are going to falter and have issues with. And now you, unless they have the same bye weeks, I don't anticipate them having it. I'm trying to check right now. I'm struggling.
No, McCaffrey has 9. Derrick Henry has 14. And then Pacheco has 6.
Okay, there we go. Okay, so now you essentially gave yourself 2 running back slots, consistently failed, regardless of injuries, with 3 RBs. Now you picked Pacheco over Josh Jacobs. Any specific reason?
I just like the offense. I like both offenses. Let's just get that. But anytime you have Patrick Mahomes in, it's no question. It's a no-brainer.
That's fair enough. Now, also one last one before we keep on going, as we did just eclipse the hour mark. Why or in what position would you rather take a tight end like Sam Laporta or Travis Kelce, as chances are they're not coming back to you in the 4th to 5th picks?
You know, I this is the year that I thought it was going to be last year, but this is the year where tight ends are actually pretty deep. I mean, you can get some really quality tight ends. I'm looking at like a Pat Freiermuth later on. I'm looking at somebody like a Dalton Kincaid. I think he would go a little earlier, but somebody like that. So I feel like go ahead, take Travis Kelce, go ahead, take Sam Laporta, hell, take Mark Andrews. You go ahead and do it. But if one of those guys does come back to me, you better believe in the 4th and 5th, because I have 4th and 5th pick, I'm getting one of those guys.
Fair enough. Now, right after Isaiah Pacheco, Marvin Harrison Jr., Devon Achane, Josh Allen in the 3rd round. And right now I currently have the draft paused. Now, I think this is where Marvin Harrison should be going, in my personal opinion. This is where I'd be like, okay, you know, I'm comfortable taking him. Devon Achane, this is also a potential same spot where I would feel pretty comfortable taking him. Eric, do you feel the same way?
Yeah. Even Travis Kelce or Sam Laporta here, it's depending on how you've built your team. But looking at like team 5, you know, that has Justin Jefferson and Chris Olave, I'm like, you know, taking a guy like a running back like Josh Jacobs, you know, Rashad White, James Cook. I think this will be a good spot for one of those players, or even like a Joe Mixon. But yeah, I would definitely go running back here.
Yeah, now drafts are always situational, but I feel like if you take 2 wide receivers, you must go a running back in the 3rd round. Go on the running back.
You just don't want to risk it. And I would agree with that.
All righty. So you know what? Let's let the CPU pick going, and Sam Laporta came off the board, which is a little unfortunate. I kind of wanted it. A little unfortunate on that one. But all right, so right now I am up on the board with Bijan Robinson and Jonathan Taylor as my first 2 picks. I got 2 running backs. So I do feel a little bit forced to take a wide receiver right now. I do feel like I don't want to leave the draft without a bona fide wide receiver. One, somebody that I could set and forget and feel pretty comfortable about that. And I'm not going to lie, I do consider Travis Kelce a wide receiver 1. I would not feel ashamed at all by taking him right now in the 3rd pick and feeling pretty comfortable about it. But right now, I guess I'll let my secret and say, no, I'm probably going to take George Kittle in like the 5th round. I'm probably going to reach a little bit and take him. That's why I don't want to take Travis Kelce if this was an actual draft and we were going that far. But right now, I want a bona fide wide receiver 1. And if Brandon Ayuk signs with the Niners or re-signs, I would take him right here. But, you know, hypothetically, I said hypothetically that we're going to assume he re-signed with the Niners. So I'm going to act on that and just take Brandon Ayuk. But assuming he has not and you're drafting now and nothing happened yet, then I'm going to tell you, of course, ignore Brandon Ayuk, put him in the do not draft dumpster list, and you're probably taking either Travis Kelce, Nico Collins, or Mike Evans. Personally would probably take Travis Kelce because he's probably the safest and in the best offense with the best quarterback. I'm not going to fault anybody for taking Nico Collins. I don't know how you feel about that, Mr. Moody.
Yeah, I would say if I were in your shoes, I would end up going like with someone like Mike Evans. Uh-huh. You just want someone that's really consistent, you know, 10 straight seasons with 1,000 or more receiving yards, you know, second longest streak in NFL history. You know, Jerry Rice has 11. But then you look at the touchdowns. He had like 13 touchdowns last season, receiving touchdowns, tied for the most in the league with Tyreek Hill. So I think he gives you a reasonable, you know, very high floor. I think he'd pair nicely with those running backs that you have. So,
yeah, that's a fair point. That's a fair point. I do like that as well. But, you know, I said Brandon Ayuk signed with the Niners, so, I got to put my money with my mouth is on that one. So Brandon Ayuk taken with my pick in the third round. Travis Kelce right after that. Josh Jacobs, 3.8. And then let's see, Mike Evans right before that.
Pretty good value. Okay, man.
That's a good value right there. The only concern is he took three wide receivers in a row.
That's interesting.
Yeah. Interesting. So AJ Brown, Puka, and Mike Evans. That being said, that's a scary wide receiving core if you're going against it. And then, of course, the team before that, Team A, is Gibbs, Barkley, and Jacobs. They're also hoarding their running backs, same as Mr. Tip. That is also a fairly scary running back group to go against every week. But Eric Moody, you are on the clock. Talk about it.
Yeah, what I'm thinking here is, let's see. Let me see who's available. Let me kind of click on the thing here. You know what? When I'm, you know, it's tough because I'm looking at Rashad White. I'm like, that would be a pretty good pick, but I'm just very high on James Cook, so that's who I would go with. I mean, if you look at all the total yards he had last year, you know, 1,567 total yards last year, third highest amongst running backs. And I also, too, when you look at Cook, I think it's an opportunity definitely to use him a lot more in the red zone, like for this year, which could even give him a higher fantasy ceiling. But just given the situation in Buffalo with the receivers that they have, you know, having Gabe Davis and Stephon Diggs gone, you know, they got Keon Coleman and Curtis Samuel, obviously. Dalton Kincaid's still there, but I just really like Cook. So just given how I'm building this team, I'm comfortable with having him as my RB1. And then I'll probably turn around and just go ahead and get like a Rashad White, you know, and just there we go. It's done. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So let me unpause it for you real fast. Mm-hmm. Now, do you feel like you're reaching for somebody like James Cook?
No, not at all. I think getting him in like the third or fourth round would be good. It really comes down to how you're building your team and also just the supply and demand of like the running back position. So I think those are going to be your two top guys. I know they're not RB1s, but they're solid RB2s. And so I would end up going Cook here and then, you know, turn around and take White. And then what I can end up doing for down the road is, or further down in the draft, I would say, is still continue to add like wide receivers, but it's some other running backs that I can end up getting later as like my RB3, like a guy like, you know, Devin Singletary, you know, could be available, like Jalen Warren, like a Zach Moss. Perhaps, you know, just depends on how it shakes out. I don't think Zamir White would probably be available, but I'd be comfortable if Pollard, Tajay Spears, someone like that as my RB3, and then just continue to add like wide receivers. So,
Sorry, you said add wide receivers. Well, Team 9 took that literally, and they added a fourth wide receiver onto the team. AJ Brown, Puka, Mike Evans, Deebo Samuel, which is really unfortunate. Really unfortunate. Actually, I think it's kind of funny.
Yeah, that's surprising.
That is surprising. he said, you know what? If you're hoarding our running backs, Tip, I'm going to hoard the wide receivers. Which, you know what? I could, you know what? I respect that. So, Team 8, they took Lamar Jackson with the fourth round for a third pick in the fourth round, and which is funny because they kind of took three running backs and then they kind of took another running back almost. Sorry, that's a little shade, but. They just took another running back in the quarterback position, which I think is kind of funny. Mm-hmm. Now, Team 7, of course, Jalen Hurts right after that. How do you feel about that? Are you, Mr. Moody, are you a quarterback early type of person, or do you feel like you should wait on that?
Yeah, I kind of prefer the wait. It just depends, you know, again, the supply and demand. I've been in some mock drafts with the ESPN crew where kind of running or quarterbacks, I would say, are going a little bit early. So, I may end up if like Patrick Mahomes is there, like in the third round or the fourth round, I may end up like picking him up. But typically I like to wait until after, I would say round six, where I can get like a Joe Burrow or a Kyler Murray. Those have been kind of my two go-to guys. So I think pretty good value and guys that can easily outperform their average draft positions and finish as a high-end QB1. So,
yeah. Now, I know we kind of went past the third round, but I just kind of wanted to ask the quarterback question there. Now, of course, you know, in a next or later episode, we'll be talking more in the mid rounds, probably like the 4 through 8, just because I feel like personally, there isn't as maybe it depends who you ask. Depends who you ask, and this is definitely opinionated, but I feel like the talent drop off is kind of significant in the wide receiver standpoint. And maybe that's unfair. Maybe that's unfair. I don't know how to properly say it.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't say it's unfair. It's like, you know, you've got your upper echelon guys. You definitely want to hammer away like wide receiver early, at least get, you know, your top two wide receivers, and one in the flex if you're being very aggressive, because there is like a talent drop off. But there are some guys available later who are getting like, who will get like a ton of targets. Guys like Deontay Johnson, Cortland Sutton are available later. But I just think it's imperative if you're in a draft, you know, you want to have at least one or two high end wide receivers early. So I wouldn't say that's off with what you mentioned.
Fair enough. Tip, do you have any, how do you feel about your team, Tip?
I like it a lot. I think that anytime you can start with really solid running backs like that, and then I'm looking at players like Michael Pittman, DK Metcalf, Cooper Kupp is still there. We talked about Cooper Kupp, Devontae Smith. Let's see. I got George Pickens there. I still think that, let's see, we've got about six picks until me. I'll get two of those wide receivers that I just named off, like no problem. Because one thing I'm looking at too, and one thing I always encourage people to do is look at the board. Look at what other people have already drafted. You've got several teams that have already drafted two wide receivers. So they're going to be looking for running backs, tight ends, quarterbacks. They're going to be looking elsewhere when I'm like, okay, I'm pretty safe to say I could probably get myself T. Higgins and I can probably get Cooper Kupp, maybe, you know. So that's something that I would always encourage people to read and look at their boards as well.
Mm-hmm. That's a fair point and a good point in that. But all right, let's wrap up this episode. Actually, real fast, who has the best team? Who had the best
start? You tell us.
It's me, obviously. See, the problem is Eric took Rashad White, so it makes his team look better. So let me remove that real fast.
I love it. That would be something if in fantasy football there was some type of league, and I'm pretty sure there are some out there where you could just you can't have that guy.
I will go ahead and say it. I do like Tip's team. We're going to three running backs, because I'm like, you look at like wide receiver. Now he may have to go to battle, say with potentially like Cooper Kupp or T. Higgins, Devontae Smith, like as his wide receivers, but he can easily just hammer away at wide receivers and really just play like the matchups and have two solid guys that could give him like a wide receiver one like week. And then let's just say if he ends up if he's available, you know, I know you may not be excited about this. What if he gets like a George Kittle? Dalton Kincaid. I really like how that squad's coming together, because he's the one that kind of went out on a limb, just like with Team 9, but going with the four wide receivers for Team 9, but going with three running backs. It gives you more flexibility, I would say.
Yeah. Well, I mean, one thing I will say, I've always been a take running backs early and often type of person, where taking three running backs in a row like that was very common for me. It's only been probably last year to this year where I feel like, you know what, maybe taking wide receivers is a little bit better, just because there's just so many elite ones now that you feel like, oh, I feel like I gotta have at least one of them, right?
Right.
All right, so let's wrap up this episode as we are going past the hour mark. Sorry about that, people and folks. All right, so that's gonna wrap up this episode. Now, Eric, can tell everybody where they can find you.
Yeah, everyone can, you know, find me obviously content over at ESPN. You know, I cover the NFL, NBA, and WNBA from a fantasy and sports betting perspective. So you can check out all my written content and audio content there. But, you know, follow me on X or Twitter, whichever one you call it. It's fine, at Eric N. Moody. So if you like all those sports and all that type of content and with a little dash of pop culture, like, you'll be right at home. So looking forward to interacting with everyone on there. I do respond to questions and answer.
He does.
And got two threads that are performing pretty well on there that anyone that kind of stumbles across my profile should check out. So
there we go. Now, what about you, Tip?
Yeah, at Tip Major. I also work on 32-bit. I work with the Cookout team. Let's see, High Point content creating team. I'm also the Rip and Tip Hour on Spaces. And then I also have a space starting in this season with Bob Harris as well. And then, of course, the last one that is my baby is our podcast that I have with Greg Kellogg and the Sports Affiliation. And, of course, this great show here on 32-Bit. So I'm all over the map on Twitter. Trying to work in the Discord. As a goal for August is I'm going to start working in Discord a little bit more. I'm in a bunch of chats, but I'm getting used to it. So I love getting used to new things. So definitely see me there soon too.
Well, there we go. All right, guys, that'll wrap up this episode. Other than that, good luck.
I'm ready for Rob today.